Now, the next technical session will be conducted by Belgaum branch.
Continuing the day, next topic on the list for today is national economy, an analysis of current scenario. As someone said in 1991, we became a breakout nation through 2009, where we turned into breakdown nation, and perhaps the current economic scenario has lots to offer an optimistic note. We firmly believe Indian growth story is still intact. Today, we have CAMR Venkatesh with us to discuss the outlook on this subject.
For this, I would request CA Sanjay S. Mudnur, the chairman, and CA Praveen Prakash Ghali, the secretary of Belgaum branch of SIRC, to escort the speaker to the dais and welcome him. A huge round of applause for both the CAs. Now I request CA Sanjay S. Mudnur to introduce our speaker.
Dear delegates, we have amongst us Mr. C. M. R. Venkatesh, who will speak on national economy and analysis of current scenario. Mr. Venkatesh is a chartered accountant who addresses the business concerns relating to economic policies, international trade, and business strategies. Mr. M. R. Venkatesh passed the CA course in the year 1992 with an All India ranking and has been in active practice since 1993. As partner in GSV Associates Chartered Accountants, Chennai. He is also a commentator on international trade and economic affairs. He is a regular contributor to various prestigious publications in India. He has authored a handbook on anti-dumping, which was released by former Prime Minister of India, Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, in the year 2001. He has authored a monograph on capital account convertibility, which was published in the year July 2006, as well as one on inflation, which was published in the year 2007. Mr. Venkatesh has also authored a book titled Global Imbalances and the Impending Dollar Crisis, which was published in September 2007 in Chennai. Mr. Venkatesh has also authored a detailed report on the farm sector in India in the context of ongoing Doha round of negotiations and the aegis of WTO. He is a visiting faculty in various professional institutions, Chamber of Commerce and University. Mr. Venkatesh has also authored a book titled Sense, Sensex and Sentiments in the year 2011. Mr. Venkatesh has also authored a book titled Dr. Manmohan Singh, A Decade of Decay in the year 2013. The book demystifies the challenges confronting India and the Indian economy in the last one decade. The foreword of this book has been authored by Dr. Subramaniam Swamy. I now request our Belgaum branch vice chairman, Shivanand Halwami, to offer a bouquet to Mr. M. R. Venkatesh. Thank you. I now request Dr. M. R. Venkatesh to take over. Thank you.
Respected friends from the Chartered Accountant Fraternity, brothers and sisters. It's a great pleasure to be here this afternoon. I'm conscious of the fact that I'm stepping in for Mr. S. Gurumurthy, who could not make it because of a personal bereavement in his family. So I know it's a pale substitution and try to do my best. After my book, Dr. Manmohan Singh, A Decade of Decay, strangely I fell silent. And I really stopped speaking anywhere and I was in deep contemplation. very difficult to be silent, let me admit. So when this opportunity came that I should substitute for Mr. Gurumurthy, it was really surprising and was taken aback. What should I speak? So last night I met him and I also discussed with him, sir, what were your thoughts and other things. Frankly, this state of the economy, after a sumptuous lunch, it's a very dismal thing. Actually, this morning there was, I'm sorry about it. Actually, this morning a doctor was there and I came and he was explaining about brain surgery. Actually, this talking about economics, post lunch is a sure way to operate your brain without anesthesia. Anyhow, facts being facts, let us come down to real life. Somewhere last year, I was asked by one of my friends, I said, Venkatesh, we wanted you to come to our company and have a look at our balance sheet. We are struggling, we want to do some re-engineering. So I said, let us have a breakfast meeting, let us meet for breakfast and start doing this work. In the breakfast, I found right from the director of finance, everybody was seated. The only fellow who was having breakfast was myself. Everybody looked, it looked as if I walked into a funeral. But I asked them, what is your problem? I said, sir, we are dividend paying, tax paying company. Dividend paying, tax paying company is 1 in 100. Why are you morose? They didn't say anything. They looked up and down. They thought they hired a wrong person. Then they looked at me. Then they gave me the balance sheet. When I looked into the balance sheet, I was surprised. Year on year, they have shown top line 20% growth on an average. Profit is there. They are paying tax. They are paying dividend. Everything is fine. But then they say they are struggling. So I asked them, you look to be very good. You shouldn't come to us. If you come to us, we'll kill you. You be happy. You are doing well. When you are doing well, don't go to a consultant. Don't fix it unless it is broke. They said, no, sir, please look at it properly. You know, some sort of hints were there. Then I looked into the investment column. I found that this company had invested around 1,000 crores in subsidiaries. And when you peruse the balance P&L figures, the return from subsidiaries was just less than a crore. I was really taken aback. 1,000 crore investment in subsidiaries and you just get a sum of less than a crore as returns. Something was terribly wrong. So when I asked them about this, they were not forthcoming. And finally, my persuasion broke down one of their junior officer. He said, sir, you know, we are in infrastructure. It requires huge payoffs. And every project is around 30 to 40% payoff. And how do we pay? This is not going and giving somebody 1,000 rupees where you can put it in a cover and give a currency note. Runs into hundreds of crores. So we have created 152 subsidiaries. And the government was so nice, 212 was amended. And some of these subsidiaries are in Cayman Islands, in Isle of Man, in Channel Islands. The company is in the business of laying roads in Chennai, but has subsidiaries in Cayman Island, Isle of Man, all over the place, name it. And all these payments are basically outbound FDI, but in reality they are kickbacks. So I immediately went to RBI and filed an RTI. Tell me how much have we parked as outbound FDI in the last 10 years and what is the return we are getting from this outbound FDI? That is, forget FDI coming to India.
We are talking about Indians investing abroad, outbound. And we know we have this immediately, if I say outbound, there will be a discussion how much, you know, how to structure the tax and other things. How do we structure outbound FDI? So many seminars happen. So I just went to it. The RBI was good enough to give me some information. Some information they did not give, but I was able to get it. Now, the figures will be stunning. Between 2004 and 2012, we have invested somewhere around $100 billion abroad. $100 billion is India's FDI outside India. Here is a country which says, I want FDI from abroad, I want FDI from abroad. But here is a country which allows FDI to go just like that. The classical thing, it has gone to Cayman Islands, Isle of Man, Mauritius, Singapore, Mylapore, all these type of small poors. And you go into the structures. Which are the structures, which are the sectors where Indian corporates have invested? Retail, $5 billion. $5 billion invested by Indian corporates outside India in retail. And Mr. Anand Sharma, the former commerce minister, says if you open FDI in retail, we will get $5 billion into India in the next 5 years. Look at the paradox. Look at the dichotomy. All these figures are hogwash, at least a good portion of them. 60% of them was in all these Cayman Islands and other things, which are nothing but kickbacks to powers that be. And the return on this RBI would not give me. He said, it's a secret. We cannot tell you how much money we are getting out of this $100 billion. I persuaded through several RTIs. And the sum is $800 million. That is less than 1%, 0.8%. If you had parked it in some saving bank account, you would have got 4 to 5% minimum. Less than 1% is the return. So there is a micro anecdotal reference and a macro figure that tells us something terribly wrong in this economy. $100 billion gone abroad, I have no issues. We are an open economy, we must open out, we must definitely put in. But what is the return? Return is zilch. And this is where I think we added the cost. So a 100 kilometer stretch of road, which would have cost say 100 crores, finally became 140 crores, 130 crores. And then the promoter saw he is paying 10 crores to that minister, 10 crores to this minister. He also takes 10 crores in his pocket. More than 10. Idella nalla audit panidunga. Out of books are being audited. Books has no relevance in this country. Let us be very clear. You can clap harder because that's a fact. Bookless audit is there, paperless. Now auditorless audit after Companies Act 2013. There will be a frame and a photograph. Who is he? He's the last auditor. Now, we have raised the cost to such level thanks to our enormous amount of bribing that a 100 crore lane, four lane road has become 150 crore. The toll for 100 rupees has become 150 rupees. And when you have to transport, say, a good piece of goods from, say, Chennai port to Bangalore, instead of paying 1,200 rupees, the fellow pays 2,200 rupees. At every single level, we have added to the cost and we have bribed ourselves to uncompetitiveness. We have bribed ourselves to uncompetitiveness to this extent that when you hold the rupee at 60, we are totally uncompetitive, and I'll come and give you statistics about it, that we are now in a very big dilemma. If you devalue the rupee to say 70, we have a huge cost of inflation because you have to raise the diesel prices and the petrol prices. And if you hold it at 60, you forget exporting abroad, people will come and import and dump goods to India. And this is happening. Now that is why the then deputy governor in a speech in November 2013 says, amongst big ticket advances, infrastructure finance has been affected significantly. It is not my statement, it is the statement of the deputy governor of RBI. Inadequate commercialization of projects due to various regulatory, administrative and legal constraints. He could have said bribe. He is using such long words. And the absence or insufficiency of user charges in many projects have put strain on the banks. That infrastructure projects in our country face such constraints is well known. He is not denying it. Yet it is deplorable that banks had not factored in such issues in their credit appraisal. He says banks must factor in out of books or ensure that contingency arrangements are in place for eventualities like inability to procure coal, gas or to acquire land for road projects. Now let us take what has happened. At every stage, because of this, when the economy was going between 2004 and 2008, when the going was good, 8%, 9%, 10%, in fact, out of 183 countries, 180 countries recorded growth in that golden period, 6 years. 120 countries roughly recorded growth above 5% during that period. And when then came the global financial crisis, and today you will find that India is not growing at 5%. Forget other small countries. India is not growing at 5%. India, which grew at 9 plus. So you are unable to sustain your tollways, your highways, your port, your so many bridges, so many airports. All that you have built have not been able to yield revenue. And I will read out, no offense meant, there was a report by the Credit Suisse, and they came out with a fantastic report about India's banking sector. Those of you who are signing bank audits, pray for Allah, Buddha, Christ. They say Adani Group, GMR, GVK, SR, Lanco, JSW, Anil Ambani Group, Videocon, JP, Vedanta, the 10 top most group other than the Reliance and the Tatas. These 10 groups had 2.6% of India's or advances, banking advances in the year 2007. And by 2012, they are 13%, meaning they have increased the loan to these 10 groups by 5 times. And out of these 10, 4 are not earning cash profits to pay interest. Forget principal. So out of 60 lakh crores of bank advances, 10 lakh crores are sticky. 10 lakh crores are sticky. It's a very dangerous situation. 1991, those of you seniors, I passed out in 1991. And when I took to practice in 92, Manmohan Singh came and destroyed all the old laws. That is my grouse with Manmohan Singh. But the day I came to practice, I was an unformatted hard disk. Completely destroyed what all I learned. So you understand how painful it is for an youngster to come and have read MRTP. When I wanted to start to practice MRTP, there is no MRTP, there is no industrial licensing, everything gone. Those crises will look like it will be a walk in the park. Because till date, we have not yet addressed the banking financial crisis now. There is a huge 10 to 15% stickiness in the banking sector. I don't know how we are going to address this. Not only this, the Credit Suisse report says 70% of the additional capacity in the private sector of thermal plants is going to come from these 10 people. And if one of them goes belly up, God forbid, we have a cascading effect in the economy too big. Too big a cascading effect. So we are in a very big problem. And not only this, how did we allow this? We allowed this when the going was good between 2006 and 2008 in those period. We artificially depressed the interest rates. We kept the interest rates lower. We allowed people to go on for a capacity building. And they said, you build huge capacities. India is growing, you know, next year 9%, next year 10%, 11%, we'll go on. As if it's a train from Chennai to Bangalore. If you leave that station, the next station, finally, you will find Whitefields and Bangalore Central. No, economy doesn't work that way. Look at the current account deficit we are running. We are running something, current account deficit in 11-12 was $183 billion. 12-13, $190 billion. 13-14, we are expected to be $140 billion. I'll come to the first 2 years, $180 and $190 billion. Where from we ran such huge current account deficits? If you look into the figures, you'll be alarmed that some of these are really unsustainable. And where did we get all those things from? Conventional wisdom. Sir, we import huge petrol. Okay, then we import gold. Then we have actually imported capital goods. We run capital goods imports of $588 billion in 9 years period. Huge. We build our capacity maximum. And of this 588, I can be assured, I am assured at least personally, a good amount of foreign exchange has gone out of this country to be parked outside. I can be very clear about it, but let us talk about this separately. $588 billion has gone out. And in these 9 years, we have imported $267 billion of gold. And the last 3 years, 10-11, 11-12 and 12-13, $160 billion of gold. Huge amount of gold has come into this country. What does that mean? When you bring in gold into this country and buy it such humongous rates, we are actually parking our savings abroad and buying gold. Because there is a buying gold is a no confidence motion by the lady in the house on the finance minister. That is the fact of matter. And I'm surprised, sir, Chartered Accountant Institute does not hold a seminar on gold. Huh? All our assets are in gold. Let us keep silent. I'll give you this wonderful book. Professor Vaidyanathan IIM Bangalore has written this book, India Unincorporated. Now look at our fascination. Actually, if you ask in the last 20 years, you ask generally any of the seniors, especially if you go and ask, sit down and discuss with economics with my father, he will say, we are spending heavily. You guys, you do not know what you are doing. All your money you are spending. But the statistic shows that India's savings rate was 19% in 1991. Today it is 35%. Contrary to the popular belief, our people go to the mall, walk around the mall in AC comfort, and come back. They don't do any buying. Our guys are very smart. Especially ladies. Wonderful way. After walking all these things, all these prices are very high. Let me go to the nearest Annachi Kadai and get it. This is what is happening. Now look at it. Of this 33% saving, 75% saving is from the household. Government and corporate is very less. Government, nothing. No loss will work to government. Government will only dissave. Corporate, some saving is there. But household saving, 75%. Now of this 75%, 60%, 70%, roughly two-thirds in the physical form. Only one-third is in the financial form. And of that one-third, I'll just go through this period. See, financial savings in the year 2004-05, 43%. Then goes to 50, 59, 52, 45, 48, 44. By 2011-12, 36. And this year it will be much lower. I'll tell you why. Correspondingly, look at the investment into the stock market. Bonds and, you know, we run newspapers, pink papers, channels, daily morning. I know cricket match is the only you know, game where they discuss 1.5 hours before the game. 2 hours after the game. Usually game is for 1.5 hours. Other sports. You know, toss. How will the toss be? How well the toss will be? Very good. Very vital. You know what he will he do after toss? Will he go and ride a bullock cart? He will either bat or bowl. As a very, very important. How will the weather impact? All these, especially Ravi Shastri, you do not know which match he is talking. Same questions. It is like CA inter paper. Same questions repeated, but students fail. I also failed in inter. Now, look at share of household investment in stock market. Very important. In 2004-05, it was 2% of the financial saving, which is a small portion, of that only 2% is invested in stock market. But yet we think India's stock index has risen to 25,000. New peak captured. What do you think? Economy is doing very well. I think there is a future that is getting discounted. Narendra Modi has come. He has brought in a new era of hope and great aspiration. Potato. Stock market, like 2% are only investing. Then look at it. 2005-06, 6%. 6-7, 7%. 7-8, height of your stock market boom. Your stock market went to 21,000 index, which we have not yet captured, adjusted for inflation even now. 10%. Then 9-10, 8-9, minus 1%. Actually, people are withdrawing money from the stock market. Mutual funds, everywhere people are withdrawing money. This is despite you giving complete tax exemption for long-term capital gains. Invest 1 year, do away with your long-term capital gains. My suggestion to the finance minister was, if some person parks money in the bank for 3 consecutive years, FD, he must be allowed income tax deduction. No income tax. Why investment in banks should not be treated on par with stock market? You give so much investment subsidy of sorts to the stock market, yet look at the figures. In 10-11 it is 0.5%, in 11-12 it is minus 0.3%. Subsequent years figures have not yet come, because government figures are usually 2 to 3 years belated, like the monsoon. So it will come slowly. But look at it. So on one hand, the entire balance sheet of the corporate sector, top line is dodgy, bottom line is dodgy. Those who sign the balance sheets, God be with you. Very dangerous situation today. Our economy's strength will be threefold. You put it like this: the household balance sheet, the corporate balance sheet, the government balance sheet. Government balance sheet, no need to look into it. True and very unfair view. So throw it out. Come to the corporate balance sheet. It looks quite good. But when you do a deeper analysis, you will find that it is dodgy. Look at our SME balance sheet. We have closed SMEs in the last so many years, 5-10 years. There is no power. Vinayaka Chaturthi, Vinayaka comes from China. Of course, with a flattened nose. Holy powder, holy comes from China. Everything comes from China. Why is it that we have not made? In the planning commission comes out with an explanation. It says 60 million jobs were added between 1998 and 2004, but 2 million jobs were added between 2004 and 2010. Why? Because SMEs, we wanted them to be closed. Credit to SMEs are not there. And what is happening? China is getting you somewhere around $240 billion worth of goods into India in the last 4 years. $50 to $60 billion every year. And what are they giving you? They are not giving you supercomputers. They are not giving you jets to fight. We are not binding arms, armaments, nothing. We have to somehow or the other stop the Chinese imports. But how do we stop the Chinese imports? We have signed FTAs all across the place. If you don't come via straight via China, it will come via Thailand, it will come via ASEAN route. And we are saying, oh, FTA is so good. Madam Nirmala Sitharaman was there in Chennai last Saturday. This time we had a meeting with her. And one of the questions was, why is it that we are not doing things? I said, Madam, please look into these figures. I'll just give you those figures now. Ease of doing business. out of 185 countries ranked by the International Finance Corporation, the World Bank, India is ranked 132. I said Companies Act 2013 will take to 182. Straight. You don't have to do anything. The Companies Act deserves to be thrown into the Arabian Sea. Don't throw it to Bay of Bengal, it may come to Chennai. Let whatever happens in Bombay happen. But there are something very important. Starting a business, we are ranked 173. To start a business, we are ranked 173. But if you look into the index of entrepreneurs, that per capita entrepreneur level in India, it is one of the highest. We are one of the highest when it comes to starting a business. She may be a flower vendor selling the flower by the hand measure, or a chartered accountant, or an Ambani. No problems. But there are more entrepreneurs in India per 100 people than anywhere else in the world. But our ease of doing business, dealing with construction permits, 182 out of 185 countries. Enforcing contracts, 184 out of 185 countries. That means if you go to a court, people think out of 185 countries, India is ranked 184. Timor-Leste is one unfortunate country ranked below us. Afghanistan is ranked better. Iraq is ranked better. Pakistan is ranked better. Uganda, Muganda, Suganda, Rwanda, all think Rwanda, everything is above us. And we come and say, we are a law-abiding country with a great constitution, sublime part 3 of the constitution which gives a fundamental rights for tattoo. Nothing works in this country. And no investment is going to come into this country unless you settle these things. Hunger index. We are ranked 65 out of 79 countries. 120 countries have fought hunger and they said no problem. Out of 79 countries, we are ranked 65. And you look at it, we talk about skill development. Forget skill development. We don't have able-bodied people to do unskilled jobs. The per capita consumption of food grains per day per capita, world over is 600 grams. We have declared self-sufficiency with 400 grams. We said half if you eat for your stomach, it is enough. And on top of this, doctors come and say, if you eat full, you'll get diabetes. And I do not know where from we are going to feed this population. And we require to produce 350 million tons. And how if you don't produce 350 million tons, we are not going to get enough food for our population. Take schooling. We send 4.4 years, just 4.4 years. Our children go to school just 4.4 years. Samoa, 10.3. Tonga, 10.3. Fiji, 10.7. Moldova, I'm not comparing the big giants, Japan's and the Germany's, no. I'm talking about countries like in Saharan Africa. We don't send our children to 10 years of schooling. And what is the quality of schooling that is left to your remain? I just want them to go to school. First, I'm not talking about the quality of school. And Human Development Index. We are ranked 132. And if you take some districts on women education literacy level, it's pathetic. So we are in a very, very precarious state. So let me tell what all needs to be done. Perhaps I got another 5 minutes more. I'm coming to that. Can you just water? Coal block allocation is to block the nation's progress. That is why we got North Block, South Block. That is to block the progress of the nation. They have named that way. I can't name it. I think we have to get more investments. Now, if you have to get more investments, the government has to do more investments first. If government has to do more investments and it has to handhold private investments, it has to do two things. I think enough of this direct tax tamasha in this country. A finance minister must be bold enough to abolish income tax for individuals. I know I'm making a very, very
bizarre and outlandish statement, but we have got only 44,000 people paying income tax above 1 crore. So we are only in a country of 1 billion plus people. Losing 44,000 assessees is not going to be a big thing. And of course, income tax revenue can be collected through other sources. In the alternative, the finance minister must come and say he will improve tax collection, not by milking the same cow several times over, which is what they do, but instead get new assessees. The target fixed for commissioners must be new assessees, not by saying that you increase 30%, so the income tax officer says 2 plus 2 is 82, and then goes on to add those things in your assessment. I think this should stop. Second, this transfer pricing is nothing but tax terrorism at the highest level. My suggestion was to the finance minister, and I have written it to him also, that first step, 100% Indian-owned companies must come out of foreign transfer pricing straight away. This external transfer pricing, if your economy is going and if you are saying that things are going to work well in this country, ask them to invest. They are going to invest in India. Why should you allow them, you know, this luxury of going through a process, bribing some officers and then parking money abroad? Right, royally we have parked $100 billion abroad, as I demonstrated. Nobody has asked any question. RBI has not asked any question. Finance Ministry has not asked any question. Third, the stock market, however much marginal it is, it's a very important vehicle for capital formation. One of the biggest problems for stock market, its integrity is sadly lacking, and that is because of an instrument called participatory notes. Participatory notes are, how many of you have heard about it? Quite a few. Good. Luckily, I was wondering this silence. Participatory notes are something that we need to stop forthwith, because they are phantom notes. You do not know who the owner is. It is Government of India sponsored Benami scheme, and it must be stopped forthwith. And we do not know who is actually investing into our stock market from abroad. Ownership is completely unknown, and that gives rights to narco terror and illicit wealth to be routed out of India through the Hawala route and brought back through the Mauritius route. You know, all know why Mauritius. And that is why I say owners of participatory notes are like chapter 2 of the Gita, where the Bhagavan defines himself as the immortal soul. He says, weapons cannot cut me, fire cannot burn me, wind cannot dry me, water cannot wet me, commissioner income tax cannot touch me, RBI does not know anything about me, SEBI cannot issue notice to me, and finance ministry is completely oblivious to me. I am participatory notes. I am the complete dominant of the world I survey in the world of finance. I think we have to... this participatory note nonsense has to stop. Then on your social indices, ease of doing business, I think today there is a meeting by the finance ministry on the new companies act. I'm very surprised when I talk to chambers, they are talking only about directors. They don't talk about auditors. When I talk to chartered accountant friends, you know this NAFRA, this has come in, this audit report is like this, this auditor report is like this. Our concerns. Then there are company secretary, you know sir, we have to file this form 3 times over, that form 4 times over, all the secretarial thing. There is no comprehensive document that gives the pain points to the ministry. And today she has called for some stakeholders, and I'm sure some stakeholders will present this case fairly strongly. But she has also told that she has got some more time, and now everything is closed in Delhi because of the budget. Post budget she will have a review. If a group of chartered accountants can sit down and write from first section till this fair end of the new act, what is the section, what is your concerns, and what is the probable solution in a 3-columnar way. We in Madras Chamber are doing this. You can also join me. We can perhaps tell her that this Companies Act 2013 is not workable. It is anti, it was probably drafted by ISI. I can tell you that much. It was not drafted in any, no proper sense could have been there. You know, every subsection has got a penalty clause, then section has got a penalty clause, then chapter has got a penalty clause, then you go to the fag end of that, then there is a penalty clause. This Companies Act, Badla, you should say Companies, Penalties and Provisions Act. So, now, coming back to some fundamental issues on the economy also, fiscal deficit, I think finance minister has to definitely take some very hard decisions. We cannot be going ahead and telling the world that we are borrowing and spending our way recklessly to richness. That world, the day of spending your way to richness is over. We have to definitely look at certain things very seriously, and fiscal deficit is one of them. Be that as it may, the finance minister's budget can be written on this paper on the reverse. 96% of them are fixed. Wages, salaries, interest, defense, all subsidies, all of them are fixed. Finance minister has got 4 to 5% of elbow room. Perhaps Jesus Christ on the cross has more elbow room than the finance minister today. So we have to necessarily ensure that the finance minister has that leverage to raise resources, and definitely one of them could be probably to tax, as he says very rightly, the natural resources. The natural resources auctioning process, unless it is worked through, we will only be finding those figures in the CAG report, but not in the finances of the Government of India papers. We have to raise resources. For that, there are enormous ways of raising. One of them is coal block, one of them is the spectrum on the 4G licenses, 2G licenses. Again and again they do come, and we can do this. Lastly, your human development index cannot be improved just by allocating 3% surcharge on education. We had this 2% education surcharge on primary education, then 1% on secondary education. I think this came in 2005. It has run for 9 years. Education in India has not improved. And my challenge to the ministry was, and in my book I had dealt with this extensively, and we have got an RTI in Chennai, where some of the schools where the teachers are actually teaching, their own children are not educated in that school. They are going to the private school. They don't want their own children to come and study in the government school where they are employed. 100%. It is not 80%, 90%. In some of the schools it's very high, 100%. And one of the things that we suggested was mandate that when you do the 7th pay commission, all government officers must send their children necessarily to government schools. Sir, for this, all these hand claps, I want some of you to raise and raise a petition also. Some of you must take this as a passion and do it. Unless we do it, and unless this group starts becoming proactive, because let us not believe that taxes are the only thing that control the economy. In today, 10 years from now, we are not going to get enough people to do certain basic work. I think plumbers, your car mechanics, sparrows, all have vanished. You don't find sparrows today. You don't find plumbers today. All these skill sets are going. And next 10 years, you won't get anything. In my state, you know, there is a big problem that 10:30 or 10 o'clock or sometime, they open up the Tasmac shop. People queue, and Tasmac, if you don't know, you know, vends liquor. People are there before the shop, try to buy the liquor at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, or 9, they want it as early as 9 o'clock. Ladies are there. So what is this happening? 10 years of economics has to be reversed. Let me give you a small anecdotal reference from Mahabharata, and I will close. This was told to me by my teacher, Professor Vardarajan, when he explained to me what is not economics. And this was what precisely this government, when I say this government, I mean the UPA government along with certain state governments have done. Kamsa actually comes to kill Krishna in the prison, and the Krishna is delivered. You know, the baby is changed and the girl baby is there. So, you know, he lifts and the baby goes out, then he is left with no baby. Then he is worried. So Krishna is alive somewhere. So he is very worried, where is this Krishna and what will happen to him? So he turns to his advisor called Bahuka. Bahuka is an economist, very, very brilliant economist. He is the advisor to Krishna. In those days, there was nothing called planning commission. Today, it is called planning commission. The Bahukas are in planning commission today. Now, when Bahuka was asked, what should I do? Bahuka said, you know, these chaps are very dangerous. You are in a very dangerous situation. So Kamsa says, shall I go and kill them? So how many fellows you will kill? Then he says, shall I transport all these good people outside the country? He said, if you transport outside the country, they will come in through, you know, all our borders are very porous. As such, we don't have visa restrictions. We don't allow Bangladeshis can come in, Nepalis can come in, Bhutanese can come in. So there is no restriction. All migration chalta hai, yaha mein kya karega? Then he said,
Bhauka says, how do I subjugate my population? Bhauka says, spend. Government must spend on liquor. Government must throw open liquor shops. People will go and stand before liquor shops in the morning. And if you whip them, they will say, please give me one more whip, but give me one more bottle. And that is how you must control the population. They will not, women must not have character. Students must not respect their teachers. You create a society where there is no discipline. Then what will happen? Those few people who are disciplined, those who are still following the path of dharma, they will say nothing can come. Not even Lord can come and redeem this. And they will throw the towel and they will go away. And in such a case, Krishna will not come. That was his beautiful answer to advice to Kamsa. We have enormous amount of bhaukas today. Advice is that you spend, you do this, you do that scheme. All these things, Amandriga, all these schemes are nothing but waste of our money. Government has to roll back, and it has to roll back tremendously. Yet Amandriga must be privatized. Amandriga cannot be run in this present form. Open a pit, close it in the evening, take 100 rupees. This type of nonsense cannot go on. We have spent 3 lakh crores. 3 lakh crores, we could have integrated our rivers. And we could have done so many things with 3 lakh crores. Unfortunately, we don't have vision. And unless we have this vision, I'm sorry to say, unless we do something dramatic about certain things, fundamentally, about water, about environment, about fundamentals like fiscal deficit, about skill development, other things can wait. But these things are so fundamental. Unless we don't touch this, I'm sorry to say, India will be an emerging destination for investment for the next 10 years. But it will never actualize. Nobody will actually put money. If you want people to put money, we have to show development, we have to show integrity, we have to show that our balance sheets are clean, we have to show our laws work, we have to show that our people deliver, we have to show there is a huge consumer market here, for that prosperity has to come in. Unfortunately, at this point in time, I must say, with all fairness, there are only dismal signs. Unless there is huge surgical strikes by this government, things are going to be very bad. Thank you. And sorry for spoiling your mood.
If anybody has any questions, it can be asked to our renowned speaker over here.
Hello. Sir, when you are comparing with other countries, India cannot be compared with other countries. The reason, population density, where the 14% of the world population residing in the 1% of the land, India has its own challenges. And the conditions, no? The probably the poverty or the illiteracy, various factors, you cannot compare saying that, no, out of 100, you are ranking 170 kind of thing. Per capita also cannot be compared.
I agree with you, we cannot compare ourselves with the world. But what I'm saying is, you cannot also say that you are reached food self-sufficiency with 420 grams of per capita consumption daily.
No, how do you increase? The challenge is,
our yields on per acre land on rice and wheat is one of the lowest. Japan has a higher density population. As you know, Japan has got 250 million people or something like that. But its population is basically in one-fifth of the land area. The four-fifth of the land area are hill. They are doing something very productive. See, our problem is, there is an agricultural science institute.
Yeah.
People will be there doing PhD. But you ask them to come and sit in the farm, they don't know anything about the farm. The yield, per capita yield per acre, has not grown up from your student days for the last 20 years. We are talking about globalization, we are talking about economy having grown, we are talking about so many things. But the farmer gets the same yield, 2000 kilos. What will he do? You can't have 50% of the population in such a precarious position, and they are in subsistence level, and then say you are a superpower. You have to address this challenge with the same much lower area. Much lower area, China is able to produce close to 500 million tons. We are producing only 250 million tons.
So we talk about technology has to be important.
Yes, we have to improve our technology in agriculture. We never talk about technology in agriculture.
And education, for instance, I am not talking about anything. I am saying put your IAS officers' children in government school. Government school will improve. And private school will get de-glamorized. Fees will come down. Middle class will be happy. Rickshaw wala, auto wallas who are sending their children to government school will find the next generation having quality improvement in their education standards.
But the fact is agriculture is not feasible in India, though it's agriculture dependent country.
It is feasible. There are three crops possible in this part of the world. In America, if you cross September, October, till April, nobody visits the farmland, especially in the north. In this part of the land, in this part of the world, you have three crops possible. Our problem is...
Sir, here the water is the problem actually. See.
Sir, water, because water storage is not there, river linkages are stable. Sir, you, in my state, every day, there is a question on me on Kaveri. You know what is my answer? Forget what Karnataka gives water to us. Whatever water they give to us, 80% is faithfully destroyed into the Bay of Bengal.
Yeah.
So we want your water into Bay of Bengal. We don't want your water. So we don't have storages. And these storages are to be done by local pond, maramat and other things, which is to be done at the panchayat level. Sir, when did you last hear about a water resources team being given the priority?
Sir, hold on, sir. When I talk about my state, it's an AP actually.
He says you are monopolizing.
No. There's a crop holiday. People are not working. Say the water facility is there, land is there, fertile land is there, but it's not working for them. So they're declaring crop holiday. The reason being, no, the prices are not
sir,
there.
Yeah. I have known several farmers' son becoming chartered accountants. The day chartered accountant son becomes farmers, then we can say agriculture has reached. Until then, we can go on top.
Hello, excuse me. Hello, yes, this side. See, we have a president of India, Pranab Mukherjee as the president of India. He was the earlier finance minister, he was also in the Congress, and from that thing, now he became, now he is an independent president of India. So he is the same one who said, you know, FDI retail is required, and then he has so many government policies, which were the policies of the UPA, which he endorsed, actually. Now, he is the same person who is trying to support BJP policies and say that, you know, it has, those policies don't work and the new policies will work. Is there no value for oneself in trying to project that what he has projected as a policy is not the same policy now? Is there no value for self-consciousness?
I think you got the constitution completely wrong, sir. You should read the Article 75.
Yeah.
The president of India does everything on the aid and advice of the government of India. That's the prime minister. Now the prime minister is supposed to have made that speech and they have given the speech to the president and he has read that speech. It is not his speech. No, there is nothing to laugh about. It is a fact of the matter. It's a constitutional provision I'm laying. God forbid you become the president and I become the prime minister and say 2 plus 2 is 72, you have to read it. You cannot say, I said 2 plus 2 is 4 to my clients in my Purvadhara as a chartered accountant. All this is gone. You are president and you are the head of the government.
I understand as the head of the government, you know, should I stick to president of India or should I read 2 plus 2 as 72 or as a value-based person should I quit the president of India and allow someone to come and then support the government in powers? Or should I stick onto the chair and then say that I am the president of India, I lose all my moral values and still continue?
Sir, we should not discuss the conduct of the president.
No, not the conduct. Actually, yeah. I'm talking about the moral and value-based state.
Sir, I think I would not answer this question. Due respect, the constitutional provision of the president is very high. We should not subject it to analysis, especially in his absence. One day we will call him here and then we can perhaps... I think so. I hope it's fair.
Yeah, I understand. What will the government, central government do if Sheila Dixit refuses to resign?
This has nothing to
sir,
do with this subject.
I was an economist. Why are you converting me into a politician? I have nothing to do with Sheila Dixit.
Because she is wanted in the jail.
No. See, let us not... I know that mine was a pretty heavy presentation and it was a dismal presentation. You cannot, you know, come out of it with such questions. I'm sorry, I refuse to take it out.
Good evening, sir. What is your opinion about Senonomics? What is your take on Senonomics? Do you think Senonomics has failed because UPS failed? My question is directed towards the fact that it was almost in a very big manner that Sonia Gandhi tried to adopt Sinonomics. And for that, many things were sacrificed. And do you think the failure of Manmohan Singh, at least especially in UPA 1, is it somehow related to the Sinonomics being implemented against him? Or why the noted economist who was so successful in his earlier venture was made to a thing? Because what is your exact take on that? Apart from the book, what is your exact take on that?
I have written too much about Manmohanomics.
Yeah,
that is. And somebody who has written around 500 pages, no, it is very tough to answer this question.
Sinonomics. First,
see, you mean Sonianomics?
No, I'm saying Amartya Sen. Sinonomics.
Okay.
Because Sonia Gandhi basically implemented that Sinonomics. That was her experiment.
NSE, that is the National Advisory Council. We call it Sonianomics. Okay. Now, see, that's why I said the Bahuka economics, I gave you an example that you spend your way to richness, doesn't work in this country because intrinsically, this country, especially the women, are rooted to culture and discipline. And that is what, it is not the men who drive this economics, please understand. Can I take 2 minutes to explain this answer? It's a very important answer. See, in 2011, when there was a downgrading of the US by this Standard & Poor, the then finance minister was Pranab Mukherjee. He came out and said, India is in a crisis. Why? America has been downgraded. But the fundamentals of our economics are strong. Now, what does he mean by that, fundamentals of economics? That means our lady in the house is ensuring savings. She is ensuring spending also. This is our beauty. We are not like China, which spends, which saves and saves and saves and doesn't know what to spend. In China, there is no spending. In our country, this month you will suddenly start saying, oh, Kaveri has come, so we'll spend some function. Next month onwards, you will have, up to Diwali, we have
Navratri,
Diwali, Dasara, all functions are there. Krishna Janmashtami, that, this is there. We spend also. But we cannot spend. Even death is a spending, 13 days. In most economies, death is a 4-hour affair. You bury it, finish it. In our day, 13 days, then monthly, then half yearly, quarterly. Like bloody LKG student, we go and write exams. You know, there are quarterly, monthly, then yearly. All rituals are there. These are all spending. You won't go and meet somebody without something. Even to a temple, you have to take some tulsi mala. All these are recession proof. Our economy is recession proof. But at the same time, you cannot say, nobody here, I am challenging you here. All, many seniors are here. None of you would have ever filed a bankruptcy for your client. Nobody. In America, you go and touch any chartered accountant lawyer, you would have said, I am filing Chapter 11 bankruptcy. Chapter 11 and divorce are very common there. Here, business also, if it goes down, your wife, if she goes down, we go on hanging to her, keep her, husband also. So, we live with the same wife and husband for 30, 40 years as if you are with the business. In America, selling business, there is no emotional attachment to the business. So a business going bankrupt is also not a problem. That gives rise to indiscipline. That this Protestant ethic of being individualistic and individual-based society with a right-based constitution has spawned economics of only spending. That is why when 9/11 happened, Bush says, what is the solution to our economics? He says, shop till you drop. He says, go and spend money. And this Bernanke, who is now the US Federal Reserve Chairman, when he was asked, if America is having a recession, what you will do? He said, I will take a helicopter, throw dollar notes all across, and then people will start spending. If they start spending, that is why I only said about the corporate and the bank and the government balance sheet. Household balance sheet is very good. It has been looted several times over since 1947. Prior to 1947, I'm not bothered. Our governments have looted our households, and this book, please read this, India and Incorporated by Professor Vaidyanathan, is a professor in Bengaluru. One of the sharpest intellect mind that you will ever come across. And this is happening. Yet we are succeeding. That is because the lady, the culture, the discipline, and only that is saving. Ideally, a finance minister, when he says, I will bring a statue of a lady in every mohalla, then the day India will get complete Swaraj. Complete Swaraj. The lady is what who manages the entire economy, not your finance minister.
The last question.
The answer to that is this. That is why Amartya Sen's economics will not work, because he doesn't distinguish between man and woman. Please understand. That is the problem. Amartya Sen's economics thinks that you don't have to spend, government will spend, and you have to be taxed.
During tea break,
the savings of the woman is well appreciated. How do you ensure that savings of the woman is put into productive areas than put into gold?
By signing clean balance sheets. See, everybody is laughing. It is not a joke, madam, it is a serious thing. And don't get into thinking that clean balance sheets are something. It is still possible. Subsidies, yeah.
What's your view on subsidies? Daily we are hearing about subsidies. This subsidy, that subsidy, and
subsidies are like sleeping pill. It will be good for 1 day, 2 days, after which it will make you a slave. That is what Bahukat said. Never get into subsidies.
Sir, I have
heard the speeches between Barack Obama and who was the other contestant? For the Republican Party. No. Kerry is his own man. I forgot, the Republican Party candidate. There were 3 debates for 90 minutes, it was telecast live. Not once do they talk about globalization. In Japan, the Prime Minister of Japan never uses Japanese or equivalent of globalization. In French, in America, in any part of the world, we don't use the word globalization. Only in India, in a globalized world, Section 80IA has to be amended. We are so fond of observing international laws and not observing national laws. World over, people don't bother about international laws. They bother only about national laws. We are the only...
Language also, we are exactly.
We
are forgetting our language.
Yes.
I agree. I think we can too.
Now, I totally understand. There are too many questions on the topic. You can get back to sir in the tea break. Hand over to the dignitaries over the dais.
Morning, there was a session for surgery on brain by a doctor. Afternoon, post lunch, we had a session on surgery of Indian economic by a chartered accountant. Sir, it was Mr. M.R. Venkatesh has presented a fantastic paper which through he has dissected the entire Indian economy as it stands current in the current scenario. I thank you, sir. I thank all the delegates for patiently hearing, and I thank one and all. I request Chetan Chaugle, my colleague in the committee, to present a memento to the speaker. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Chairman.